Now, students, agents of pollination is broadly divided into two categories. Number one is abiotic agents. Number two is biotic agents. So here, in the case of agents of pollination, as I said you briefly in the previous class, now today I would like to discuss detailedly. So the abiotic factors or abiotic pollination, we'll see. The first one is anemophily. So this is the anemophily. Nothing but by wind the pollination will takes place. Then in this anemophily, the flowers will be having the carpel and pistil, no? So the feathery stigma we'll see in the case of anemophily pollinating flowers. And one more is pollen grains are light and also non-sticky. Pollen grains are light and non-sticky. Feathery stigma we'll see in the case of anemophily. By wind, the pollination has taken place. So, examples for this is grasses. So, Graminae family. All the grasses included in the family called Graminae. Next is hydrophily. So, in the case of hydrophily, by water, the pollination is taking place. And here, rare in flowering plants. So, hydrophily we'll see rarely in flowering plants. And few monocots, they will exhibit hydrophily. In our textbook, they have given the importance for one more hydrophily member, Vallisneria. Students, don't forget Vallisneria, because in board exam also they used to ask, in 3 marks question they used to ask, write about Vallisneria, because in Vallisneria we'll see the flowers, female flowers will be having long stalk and the flowers reach the surface of water. So with a long stalk, female flowers of Vallisneria, they are reaching the surface of water. Then pollen grains released on the surface of water. So we can see here the female flowers reach the surface of water and pollen grains will be released into the water and they will come on the surface of water. So through water currents, pollen grains reach the stigma and then the pollination is taking place by water. So such a type of pollination is said to be hydrophily. You people should not forget Vallisneria, because it is important for NEET exam also, because here the hydrophily pollinating flowers of Vallisneria, they are having specific characters. What are they? By a long stalk, the female flowers are reaching the surface of water. And at the same time, the release of pollen grains will be into the water. And pollen grains also, they are coming on the surface of the water through water currents. Pollen grain reach the stigma, then the pollination is taking place by water. So that is called hydrophily. And one more important point, listen. In water pollinated species, pollen grains are covered by mucilaginous layer. So mucilaginous layer is very important. Why? The pollen grains are covered by mucilaginous layer because to protect from wetting. That is only the reason the pollen grains which are water pollinated species are showing their pollen grains are covered by mucilaginous layer to protect from wetting. Examples under these hydrophilic members, examples are given. Hydrilla is one of the plant and which is freshwater plant. Hydrilla is freshwater plant, whereas the second one, Zostera is marine water plant. So students, don't forget these examples as well as the important character of water pollinating species there. The pollen grains are covered by mucilaginous layer. Later, what we have to see is in our content in that chapter, sexual reproduction in flowering plants, they have given the body of the animal gets a coating of pollen grains. So the some of the animals also involving in pollination. So the body of the animal gets a coating of pollen grains. They are sticky. That's why what happens when the animal carrying pollen on its body comes in contact with the stigma and bring pollination. Like that it is happening in the case of some of the large animals. So for that sake, this is also one of the important point which we have to remember. So some of the animals also involved in pollination. So the animals such as already we came to know birds also there. So by birds if the pollination has taken place means it is called ornithophily. Don't forget. So ornithophily is taking place by birds. Meanwhile, if you take the examples of that birds, sunbirds are the best ones, and not only that, hummingbirds also. Sunbirds, hummingbirds, and so on. Other birds also involving in pollination. That's why it is called ornithophily. Then I said just now, the large animals, some primates, lemurs are the best examples. The primates, lemurs are the best examples, the large animals under that, and they also involved in pollination. Then arboreal, that means tree dwelling ones. The tree dwelling ones means rodents. So rodents, best example is squirrel. Squirrel is a one type of a rodent. So that is also there. Then even the reptiles also. Gecko lizard, G-E-C-K-O, gecko lizard, it is a reptile. So even reptiles like gecko lizard and another one, garden lizard, also reported as pollinators. So that's why you please remember the large animals also involved in pollination. Now students, here one more is given, that is water hyacinth. So already we came to know in first chapter, that is reproduction in organisms. There I told very clearly about water hyacinth. So water hyacinth is nothing but Acarnia. So Acarnia, it is a terror of Bengal. So I need not go into that chapter. Simply I am making you to remember and reminding you. Water hyacinth and one more, water lily. These two flowers are emerged above the level of water and pollinated by insects. So here the pollination in the case of water hyacinth, water lily, flowers are emerged above the level of water. That's why pollinated by insects. So mostly the best ornithophily members are honeybees. That's why here simply mentioned bees, butterflies, then beetles, wasps. All these comes under ornithophily. filly and best example here I have given already. So then symbiotic relationship, before going into the symbiotic relationship, I would like to say one more important bit, that is some species floral rewards are providing safe places to lay eggs. So some of the species, the floral rewards are in providing safe places to lay eggs. Best example for that is the tallest flower, Amorphophallus. Students, remember, Amorphophallus is the flower which is 6 feet in height. Amorphophallus is very, very important scientific terminology given to that, and it is the largest flower. Why here it is mentioned means it is 6 feet in height. At the same time, because of its bigger in size, it is giving safe place to lay eggs to some of the insects. So students, that's why here that is said to be the some species floral rewards are providing safe place to lay eggs. Amorphophallus is the best example. Now coming to the symbiotic relationship. So symbiotic relationship here between yucca plant and also moth. Yucca plant is there and then moth is there. And this moth, scientifically, it is said to be Tegeticula. Tegeticula is the moth. So these two, yucca plant and moth, Tegeticula, they can't live without, that means moth cannot live without yucca plant, and yucca plant cannot live without moth insect. That is the symbiotic. It is a very rare type of symbiotic relationship between yucca plant and moth. So in the case of the symbiotic relationship of yucca plant and also the moth, what happens? The female moth, that is Tegeticula female, is entering into the, that means it will visit the yucca plant flower. So at what time they visit? Night times. So at night times, the yucca plant will be there. No, when they blossom the flowers at night, then the female moth will enter into the yucca flower. So where it enters means it will enter and lay eggs in the locule. So the female moth of Tegeticula will enter into the flower of yucca, and where it enters, it will enters into the locule. So in the previous class only I told what is locule, the chamber which is present on the ovary, that is called, or the placenta, that is called locule. So inside the locule they will lay egg. That means the female moth will enter into the locule and there it lays eggs. So while it is entering into the yucca flower, what happens to the head of the female moth? Of the head is having the pollen balls. So the pollen balls are sticking to the head of the moth. For that sake, while after entering into the locule of the yucca flower, then it will lay eggs in the locule. No, then it is coming out and going top of that flower. At that time, the pollen will touch the stigma and pollination is taking place. So this is the wonderful thing, which wonderful symbiotic relationship which we'll see between yucca plant and moth. Okay students, then coming to the next one, that is outbreeding devices. Next is outbreeding devices. So in the case of outbreeding devices, it is very, very important for 5 marks questions, students. It is very important for 5 marks questions. So whatever I am stressing, please make a note. If you have notebooks, it is well and good for you. Or if you have textbooks also, doesn't matter. You please make a note, outbreeding devices. It is very, very important question and it is asked in 5 marks question. That's why essay type question. So 5 marks question, that's why you please make a note of it. So in outbreeding devices, what is happening here? I told as a first point, hermaphrodite flowers. So you are knowing the meaning for hermaphrodite. So hermaphrodite means bisexual flowers and they are also said to be monoecious, isn't it? So in hermaphrodite flowers, what is happening? Because both male and female sex organs or sexual parts are present in a single flower, that's why self-pollination is taking place. So in outbreeding devices, the first device is hermaphrodite flowers. So the ones who are having hermaphrodite flowers, self-pollination is taking place. If this self-pollination, if it is continuous, what happens? So, inbreeding depression occurs. Inbreeding depression is also very important 1 mark question and neat point of view. So, inbreeding depression means, why inbreeding depression is taking place? Because of repeated or continuous self-pollination. Okay, students? Self-pollination, when it continues, then inbreeding depression occurs. So you might be thinking, what is inbreeding depression? So inbreeding depression means reduced fertility power and productivity. So fertility will be reduced, that power will be reduced, and productivity is also reduced. When these two are there, then such condition is said to be the inbreeding depression. Same inbreeding depression, same term, it is you may come across in the other lessons, that is strategies for enhancement in food production. Strategies for enhancement in food production, same terminology is going to see. Okay, inbreeding depression means there it is also same, the meaning will be same, reduced fertility and productivity. So this is the first outbreeding devices. Coming to the next one, the second device is flowering plants developed to discourage self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination. Students, listen. Flowering plants developed what? To discourage self-pollination. So because of continuous self-pollination, we are seeing here inbreeding depression. That's why they wanted to discourage self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination. So that is the second device. In the case of flowering plants, what happens? They have developed many devices to discourage self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination. That's why in some species, pollen reach and stigma becomes receptive are not synchronized. So same word is given in the textbook, synchronized. In same species or in some species, pollen release and stigma becomes receptive, both are not coming at a time. That means they are not synchronized. Synchronized in the sense not at a time. That is the meaning for synchronized. Pollen release before the stigma receptive, or stigma becomes receptive after the pollen release. So that is called here synchronized. And in some other species, anther and stigma are placed at different positions. So if you see in the flower, the anther and also The anther and the stigma are placed at different positions so that what happens, pollen cannot come in contact with the stigma of same flower. Both these devices prevent autogamy. So both these two devices what I explained just now, they are, both these devices prevent autogamy only. Understand students? Next, the third device. So here you can see third device to prevent inbreeding, self incompatibility. So self incompatibility means unable to exist together. Unable to exist together. So in this third device, what is happening to prevent inbreeding is self incompatibility. That means unable to exist together. It prevents self-pollination. It prevents self-pollination from the same flower or other flowers of the same plant. So that is the thing. So from fertilizing ovules by inhibiting pollen germination or pollen tube growth in the pistil. So that is happening in the case of a third device. So students, you please make a note. These are the three devices which I explained. The first one is the one which is hermaphrodite flowers. Here self-pollination is taking place because of the bisexual nature of the flower. When that self-pollination is continues, then inbreeding depression is taking place. So inbreeding depression means reduced fertility and productivity. Then coming to the second one, that is flowering plants develop to discourage self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination. The third one is to prevent inbreeding, that is self-incompatibility, unable to exist together. Then fourth one is production of unisexual flowers. This is very important. So unisexual flowers, in the case of here, what happens, prevents autogamy but not gynogamy. So they will prevent the autogamy but not gynogamy. So already you came to know xenogamy, gynogamy, autogamy, or the other name for autogamy, homogamy, all these things. So that's why here this is the production of unisexual flowers. Because of that, the device what else, it prevents autogamy but not gynogamy. And one more last important point, that is papaya. Don't forget this papaya, important for competitive point of view, neat, because it is giving male flowers in one papaya plant and female flowers in another. So these two, that means unisexual flowers we are seeing here. So these flowers are present on different plants. Such type of condition or such condition will be called as diocy. So this is very important, students. Diocy means best example for diocy is papaya, because unisexual flowers are produced in different plants. Then they prevent autogamy and also gynogamy. So that is the important characteristic feature which you have to remember. The diocy is the best example for diocy is papaya, prevents autogamy and gynogamy. Thank you, students, for listening.